So welcome to our webinar with the title, The Zelenko Early Treatment Study, The Role of Zinc and the Therapeutic Approach to COVID-19, also, let's say, in a short summary in Germany. Next. Just my conflict of interest, my engagement and contribution to COVID-19 research, including all related publications, and especially the study we are talking today about, has been private and independent from my employer. Next. Here our agenda. At the beginning, maybe a few words about the arrival of SARS-CoV-2 in Germany. Probably not everybody knows this story. Then a few details why zinc and why this group then also came together. Then, of course, we will talk about the Zelenko protocol and the retrospective case series studies we published recently. Then, as I said, a short update, how is Germany doing currently in the pandemic? Are there perhaps, when we think even of guidelines and recommendations, how to manage outpatients and inpatients better examples somewhere in the world? And at the end, also a short conclusion, what is still missing in COVID-19? And as we just heard, is also more and more discussed among physicians, scientists, and even politicians. Next. So how and when did SARS-CoV-2 arrive in Germany? What is quite interesting, I mean, I'm just in the Munich area in Germany, and just a few kilometers away where I'm sitting now, there was patient zero arriving, indeed a Chinese resident visiting the headquarters of her employer in the Munich area from January 19th to 23rd this year. And just before, obviously, she also saw her parents from Wuhan. And so patient number one in Germany was a colleague of her, a male 33-year-old employee of the company with a confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infection after having had symptoms of like a common cold before being diagnosed and confirmed on January 27th. The company reacted very well, also not used, of course, to this kind of crisis management, but they completely shut down their headquarters for the next 2 weeks, what was for sure key for the success to control, let's say, the pandemic in this company and in this area. And between January 27th and February 11th, 16 cases of COVID-19 were indeed identified in this cluster, emerged in four transmission generations. So these patients were then isolated in a qualified hospital, mostly demonstrated a mild cause of the disease, symptoms like headache, aches, shortness of breath. Two patients only had pneumonia, and the documented mean incubation time was 4 days. Next. All this data in detail, by the way, including viral load and the development and management of this patient, was then also quickly published in Nature in May 2020. And if you're interested in, I can only recommend to read this publication about the first patients, how they were managed, and about also the very comprehensive and interesting findings. Next. What we learned quickly in the pandemic in terms of pattern of the disease progression, that obviously 80% of the patients are showing mild to moderate symptoms. And maybe that was at the beginning an issue of the pandemic also in Germany, because young people were told that this is not probably so relevant and more relevant for the older patients. So in terms of spreading the infection, early of the year, probably different recommendations would have been more favorable. Nevertheless, we learned quickly also that 20% are suffering from severe disease and even critical disease, being at a much higher risk of death. And this proportion of 20% is becoming again interesting when we come also to the results of the publication and the treatment of patients by Vladimir Zelenko. Next. So How about the age and comorbidities of COVID-19 patients? Also a quick learning. I was, as a physician, very interested at the beginning of the year to read the emerging evidence publication, etc. So here a summary of more than 5,000 patients in the New York City area demonstrating that of hospitalized patients, COVID-19 patients, demonstrating that these patients were older, had many comorbidities, as you can see in the second red box. And on the right, you see, of course, the typical distribution you would expect in terms of comorbidities when it comes to hypertension, coronary artery disease, heart failure, but also metabolic disease, obesity, and diabetes. So basically, we are talking about a high-risk population being older and demonstrating typical risk factors, as you would expect also in primary care when you see these patients. Next. So the question is, why zinc? And for example, why got I involved in being, let's say, more interested in and doing some more desk research and so on. And the truth is, to be very honest with you, that just December 19, I met a very good old friend from medical school, and she's an expert, let's say, in zinc, how you measure zinc, the relevance of measurements, supplementation, and so on. So I think I had a basic knowledge about zinc, but this longer conversation with her, also about other topics, of course, I remembered very well. When it came to the comorbidities, as well as to the risk of these patients in terms of these coronavirus infections, the question really then came up, might zinc play a role? If we go to the next. So how about zinc deficiency? Zinc deficiency indeed was before confirmed in a large number of healthy elderly, and not only in development countries, but even in the Western world. There's enough data available. I thought it was interesting that zinc deficiency was also confirmed in the literature in diabetic patients. And concerning my industry background as a physician, I knew that antihypertensive drugs like hydroxychloroquine, thiazide, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, as well as angiotensin II receptor antagonists, can indeed result in increased urinary excretion of zinc with subsequent systemic zinc deficiency. And of course, there would have been for sure a lot of other parameters, indicators, whatever. But nevertheless, I found that very interesting they're reading literature that age comorbidities and relevant co-medications align very well with the majority of described COVID-19 patients being obviously at high risk of the disease. Next. The question was, what are possible effects of zinc when, for example, used as a supplement? Zinc, of course, is known to be needed for an effective antiviral response. It is well known that zinc elicits activity against several viruses, as published for hepatitis E virus. And there were also publications showing that zinc inhibited the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, and that also zinc ionophores block coronavirus replication. Next. Zinc ionophores are in general defined as substances which are able to transport particular ions across a lipid membrane in a cell, as you all know. And I was also aware of the publication that chloroquine is a zinc ionophore. I was thinking, I think it was end of February probably, and then beginning of March, if chloroquine and probably hydroxychloroquine might increase intracellular zinc concentrations in COVID-19 patients, and that this might be perhaps beneficial. So that was a time, I mean, when you sit there with your own thoughts you need to pressure test them. When I got into contact with my former colleague and friend, Professor Martin Scholz. Next. And we were discussing this concept and then decided that it might be so interesting that we should probably write it down as a hypothesis paper. And this is exactly what we did in March, as quick as possible, and published it in Medical Hypothesis with the title, Does Zinc Supplementation Enhance the Clinical Efficacy of Chloroquine or Hydroxychloroquine to Win Today's Battle Against COVID-19? By doing so, thank you, by doing so, publishing it as a preprint first, and then after peer review it, when it was finally coming out, we already got then into contact, or we got notice of and got into contact with Vladimir Zelenko, and we thought it would be a good idea to mention that there's obviously a physician out there in primary care treating his outpatients already with a protocol including hydroxychloroquine 200 milligram twice daily, zinc sulfate 220 milligram once daily equal to 50 milligram elementary zinc, and azithromycin 500 milligram once daily. And we stated that it would be helpful to have a detailed analysis of these patients, what was ongoing or just started during that time, at least the idea started, to get more guidance for clinical practice on the one hand, but of course also for more clinical trials and hopefully even randomized clinical trials. In the conversation then with Dr. Zelenko, we decided to support his effort to analyze this data. Next. And maybe already here, I mean, Vladimir Zelenko, he was treating physicians, right? A lot of sick physicians coming with suspected COVID-19. He, of course, did not have the plan or idea to do any kind of study or publish data. So this was all coming up in discussions and conversations he had with also interested physicians and experts to see how this population looks like and what the outcome might be. And based on these conversations, as I already told you, we decided to support his efforts in terms of, for example, developing a protocol, putting a data matrix together based on de-identified data, analyze it statistically, and then putting together the manuscript, submitted first as a preprint, and then finally and recently accepted here as a peer-reviewed article in the International Journal of Antimicrobial Agents. Next slide. Exactly. So the aim of this exercise and effort was to describe the outcomes of the patients treated in this outpatient setting after early treatment with the triple therapy you already heard about, including zinc, rather a low dose, hydroxychloroquine doses and azithromycin. And this also depended on risk stratification. So the setting was a primary care practice of patients with confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infection. And the patients included in this analysis were treated from March 18th to May 14th. We then decided to close, let's say, the database. Quickly, of course, the question was coming up, is there any group of comparison? I mean, as we said, Vladimir Zelenko, he did not plan a study and then treated patients. He took care about his patients. And then the question was coming up, can his data be analyzed? We talked, of course, to a lot of statisticians, as you can imagine. You could have taken different populations that were published, for example, New York City. But of course, all these would not have been comparable. And so the best denominator, let's say, we found was then public reference data, at least of the same community. And that data was then used. And as you will later see, of course, we did not have access to a lot of details of these patients, unfortunately. So this is, from a design perspective, a retrospective case series studies in the general practice setting. And SARS-CoV-2 was confirmed by PCR, but in the pandemic, many patients did not have access at the beginning to PCR testing. In the analysis, also patients that were clinically diagnosed and retrospectively confirmed by IgG detection tests, as you will see in the flow, were also included. The advantage of this analysis for sure is that 100% of all included patients had a laboratory confirmed diagnosis. And I mean, when you go through the literature, even in high-ranked journals, there are examples with only 3% of patients who had a confirmed laboratory diagnosis. But here, it was a decision also based in the protocol to include only 100% confirmed patients, and not only diagnosis, for example, based on clinical judgment only. Next. Then, what is also important, not all patients with a confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infection and COVID-19 were treated, but Vladimir Zelenko was indeed applying a risk stratification. So there are three groups. Group A were patients older than 60 years, and these ones with or without clinical symptoms. Group B, patients 60 years or younger with shortness of breath, so first symptoms that probably the infection is progressing to the lower respiratory tract. And group C, patients 60 years or younger, clinically symptomatic with at least one of the described comorbidities, as you find it here in the list and, of course, in the publication. The today so-called Zelenko protocol for these and only for these positively risk stratified patients was as described: zinc sulfate 200 milligram once daily, HCQ 200 milligram twice daily, azithromycin 500 milligram once daily. And this triple therapy was given for 5 days, and Vladimir Zelenko did not use an HCQ loading dose. The not positively risk stratified patients got standard of care to treat common upper respiratory tract infections and recovered at home, and of course were monitored, and in case of any increase in terms of severity of the disease, they would have come back or been referred to a hospital. Next. Further documentation included the demographics of the patient, the clinical symptoms, vital signs, main co-medications, including corticosteroids, and documented adverse events. Next. The defined outcome was COVID-19-related hospital admission as well as all-cause death during the defined time of follow-up of at least 28 days in the treatment group and also in the untreated control group as public reference as available. Next. So this is an important figure, and we should spend some time on that one to really understand which patients were stratified, treated, selected, and also included in the analysis. We got, of course, a lot of questions when the manuscript was already available as a preprint. So in this community, when we stopped inclusion of, let me say, more cases in the analysis, 712 patients were PCR-confirmed COVID-19 cases. 335 of these presented as outpatient in the primary care setting at one general practice. And after the risk stratification, 208 of these patients did not meet the risk stratification criteria, got standard of care, and recovered at home. 127 of these patients got the triple therapy. And in the analysis, we excluded 23 patients because we saw that they did not meet the risk stratification criteria, but were obviously treated for other clinical reasons. But to be consistent, of course, in the analysis, we were not able to include these patients. And indeed, many of them were also younger patients. So we had 104 patients available, of course, time was running, many patients were also treated based on clinical judgment to protect them. And afterwards, these patients, at least some of them, were IgG tested. And 37 of these patients who also met the risk stratification criteria and had a positive IgG test were then included in the analysis, ending up with a total population of 141 patients positively risk stratified in accordance to the defined criteria and treated with the triple therapy in comparison to 377 patients. The outcome was available in this community. Next. How about the baseline demographics of the three different groups? As you can see in the table, group A, remember the patients older than 60 years, group B, the younger ones with shortness of breath, and group C, the younger ones with comorbidities and symptoms. You see a typical distribution in the older patients of hypertension, hyperlipidemia, diabetes, and obesity. You see, especially in the patients with shortness of breath and younger than 16, group B, 19% of patients, for example, with asthma. And concerning group C, you see a relatively high proportion with 42% of patients with obesity. Next slide. How about the reported days since onset of symptoms? Indeed, these patients, as we will see also in comparison to the literature, were treated very early with a median after 4 days. Next. The clinical symptoms reported, often reported symptoms were cough and dry cough, followed by fever, then of course, a relevant number of patients with shortness of breath. And what was quite interesting to see also, let's say more or less still beginning of the year in May when we started the analysis, that there was a relevant group of patients with documented changes to concerning smell and taste. With the number of 30% percentage for all patients, this fit very well to the reports in the literature during that time. All these patients were laboratory confirmed, and this can be almost used as a control when you read next time publications about these patient populations. Have a look if this is documented, especially if they are not laboratory confirmed. This number provides a good hint, about this population and how many patients probably really had COVID-19. Next. Also very interesting, the vital signs, because, for example, the respiratory rate of these patients, but also pulse oximetry values were all in the normal range. So what does it mean? It means when these patients showing up in an outpatient setting, there's no reason to admit these patients to hospital, obviously. So these patients were still in stage one or stage 2A, as we will see on a figure later on. So they had COVID-19 confirmed, but rather still mild symptoms. And most of these patients worldwide during that period of time would have been sent home to self-quarantine and wait and watch. Next. Concerning the co-medications, as you would expect, in terms also of the demonstrated or documented comorbidities, included antihypertensive drugs, asthma medications, and 9% of patients took oral corticosteroids. These were not prescribed because of the COVID-19 diagnosis, but because patients had, for example, autoimmune disease. Next. What's the outcome of the study? What we saw in comparison to the public reference data, treated patients were significantly less hospitalized. We saw a numerical trend in terms of all-cause death. As you see in the paper, one patient in the treatment group died, and we also published some more clinical details about this patient. This patient was a cancer patient. was only able to take the triple therapy for one day, was then admitted to hospital and unfortunately then deceased. Next. Here you see the odds ratios and the respective p-values, as well as the forest plot. Hospitalization reduction of odds of 84%, highly significant. All-cause death reduction of 80%. And as I already mentioned, based on this analysis, not significant, but a clear numerical trend. Next. What is interesting, as I just mentioned, in terms of the analysis, the patients in the treated group, as you saw, were all positively risk stratified. The risk of the untreated control group was lower because this group included the high-risk patients, of course, most likely, but also low-risk patients, you can assume. I mean, we don't have the data, don't get me wrong, but nevertheless, this group of patients was not risk stratified. As we got a question, we compared the outcome of all risk stratified patients in the study group, meaning the treated and the non-treated patients, with the control patients who were not stratified, treated with standard therapy and recovered at home. And so when we take all these patients into the analysis, the not positively risk stratified and for good reason not treated, and the positively risk stratified treated with the triple therapy, we see a confirmation, of course, of the reduction in hospitalization, highly significant. But you then also see in this population a significant reduction of all-cause death. We did not show the data. This is included in the discussion only. We did not show the data in the results section because relevant clinical information, as you know, was not available for these patients in the control group to allow for any risk adjustment between groups. At least for any other, also maybe trials, et cetera, and settings, this might be another indicator based on this data. Next. Concerning adverse events, documented, not a lot of surprises in these sick patients in terms of any adverse event, weakness, nausea, or diarrhea. For example, at first consultation, around 6% already had diarrhea, and here during the course of the treatment, 11% were documented and rash with 1%. And what was important, no patient reported palpitations or any cardiac side effects. And patients at a possible risk for cardiac side effects, of course, did not get the treatment in this practice. Next. So let's come to the discussion. This first retrospective case series, this is the first retrospective case series study of COVID-19 outpatients in a primary care setting. And when we published it, it was indeed the first one worldwide to our knowledge, because all the other trials were done in a hospital setting. And the study results provides needed recommendation, as we think, for a risk stratification and an early treatment of patients to be able to prevent hospitalization and death of COVID-19, in addition to other pillars, of course, of the pandemic, like avoiding infections, number one, then also in terms of hospital management, and as a fourth pillar, in terms of vaccine development. But so far, the early treatment of COVID-19 outpatients in the primary care setting was not in the focus. Next. It is known, and we have seen this in this patient population as well, that it's obviously critical to start the antiviral triple therapy as early as possible after symptom onset. While it is known that SARS-CoV-2 viral load appears to peak at days 5 to 6 after symptom onset, that severe cases progress to RDS after only 8 to 9 days, And it is established knowledge that an early antiviral treatment to manage severe disease progression is important and was also shown for influenza in different publications. You need to treat early with your antiviral therapy that is available for influenza, as you know, because otherwise with every day, the benefit is step by step decreasing in these patients. Next. The meantime, as you saw, was from symptom to treatment was only 4.8 days. The median was 4 days. And in previously reported time spans available when we did the analysis of the studies ranged from 6.3 days to 8 days, up to 16.6 days when hydroxychloroquine then was still used, or indeed was even often not reported. And our hypothesis is that in many other studies, COVID-19 disease had most likely already progressed at the time of presentation to stages 2 or 2B and even stage 3 of the disease. Next. Early treatment is obviously important based on this data and more emerging observations, and underscores for sure the role of early intervention by primary care physicians before patients need to be hospitalized. And also what is important that by applying the shown risk stratification approach, as Vladimir Zelenko did, the respective care was indeed tailored only to patients with a higher likelihood for hospitalization or fatality. So the result was that 62% of COVID-19 patients being risk stratified were treated with standard of care only, recovered at home, and only 37%, or let's say 38%, needed treatment with triple therapy. And when we go to the next, you see that the majority of patients did not need this triple therapy, and there's no need to treat all COVID-19 outpatients with zinc low-dose hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. And when you remember the figure at the beginning of my presentation, that 20% are obviously then suffering from a more severe cause of the disease, and here 38% were treated. That fits somehow very well. Also, it's not directly linked. Nevertheless, you can see that definitely only a higher risk patient population was treated in this primary care setting based on the defined risk stratification, including three different groups. Next. What has to be taken for sure also into account, thinking of management of COVID-19 patients, is the long terminal elimination half-life of HCQ. And this has not been discussed very often previously. HCQ has a half-life of terminal elimination half-life of 32 days in plasma and 50 days in blood. And so the advantage of the triple therapy was obviously that the dosing approach in comparison also to other studies was rather conservative. The starting dose was the same as the maintenance dose, and only a short treatment duration was used of 5 days. Concerning the mode of action, I think you're all aware of that HCQ increases the pH, especially in lysosomes, inhibiting the pH-dependent SARS-CoV-2 replication, especially when it comes to entering the intracellular room out of the lysosome. And chloroquine and HCQ probably as well has characteristics of zinc ionophores, thus increasing then the intracellular zinc concentration. Next. However, the proper dosing of HCQ with its long half-life might be key for a favorable outcome of COVID-19 patients. Why? We have seen that in many studies with patients being hospitalized or even on the ICU, HCQ was used, and it is known and common practice that in critical care, drugs with a short half-life is usually preferred, So HCQ is probably not an ideal drug for severely ill patients on the ICU. Especially in these patients, critically ill patients, higher doses may have unforeseeable effects when it comes, for example, to insulin sensitivity in obese patients and also on glucose levels in diabetics. And it is also important to closely monitor renal function, which is increasingly affected during progression of COVID-19, because HCQ is substantially excreted by the kidneys, and the risk, of course, of toxic reaction is greater in patients with impaired renal function. And this makes the treatment of high-risk and severely ill patients with HCQ for sure even more difficult. Next. The dose of zinc was similar to doses previously studied to successfully prevent infections in the elderly. We already talked about the effect on the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. But there's another hypothesis we propose and discuss also in the paper, that zinc might inhibit the serine protease furin. Furin is expressed on endothelial cells, for example, macrophages, smooth muscle cells in human atherosclerotic plaques, might play a critical role for the severe cardiovascular complications as well, but might be also responsible to favor spreading of SARS-CoV-2 compared with other beta coronaviruses. And as furin inhibition protects from certain viral-dependent infections, it may be important also to test the possible role of zinc inhibiting furin, so not only the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, perhaps also furin, because this was also described at least once in the literature before, but is currently not known for SARS-CoV-2. Next. Azithromycin was added to the triple therapy and based also on the research Vladimir Zelenko did in terms of the literature research and information that was available during that time, based on preliminary data for more efficient or synergic virus elimination in conjunction with bacterial superinfection. Next. The role of zinc deficiency, I think I presented and explained already, but zinc deficiency might explain why certain patient groups seem not to benefit from HCQ monotherapy. And we will later see that there's also more and more emerging literature about this topic. Next. So also important during the 5-day treatment with the triple therapy, including hydroxychloroquine, no severe adverse events were observed. No cardiac arrhythmia was reported in this general practice, what is in accordance with available safety data for more than 300,000 patients. And I think, as everybody on the line knows, that hydroxychloroquine is used for a long time, also in autoimmune disease in many patients. And of course, possible, for example, a cardiac disease, etc., or complication needs to be ruled out before, and the patient needs to be monitored and followed. Next. What are the limitations of the study? I mentioned at the beginning of the webinar of course, that was not a blend prospective study, very interesting data was generated when all these patients were treated. So that's a retrospective, of course, non-randomized and also not blinded treatment. We only had the outcome data for the public reference available, as I explained. So no adequate risk adjustment was unfortunately possible. Confounding factors, selection bias might exist. ECG for all the patients were not done and are not available. Also, triple therapy resulted in a numerically lower rate of all-cause death. In the absence of clinical details about the untreated patient group, the lower rate of all-cause death in the treated group was not statistically significant. And patients in the treated group were all positively risk stratified, as we have seen, while the risk of the untreated group was obviously lower as this group included high and low risk patients. Next. What are important implications, nevertheless, of the study? Clinical experience, as I already mentioned, from severely ill patients with pneumonia who were treated with higher and sometimes much higher doses of HCQ or even chloroquine, is for sure not transferable to the outpatient setting and patients with upper respiratory tract disease only. For outpatients with a short period of time, like here with after 5 days after onset of symptoms, COVID-19 represents a totally different disease and needs to be managed and treated differently. A simple to perform outpatient risk stratification, as you saw, allows for a rapid treatment decision, in our opinion, and treatment with the triple therapy with zinc, low dose HCQ and azithromycin is obviously or can be beneficial. It may prevent a large number of hospitalizations and probably deaths, and this hopefully might help to avoid overwhelming of healthcare systems. And as we always said, of course, more data at the end would be needed. Next. Nevertheless, I mean, we all know how much criticized HCQ was in the course of this pandemic. And as I just mentioned, there's obviously a certain group of patients we already know, also from randomized placebo-controlled trials, that HCQ does not have a benefit. And this is obviously true for the severely ill patients. And this means here on this figure, probably patients with a stage 2B. This means patients with shortness of breath and already showing signs and symptoms of hypoxia. And you remember in terms of the vital signs of the patients our analysis, that none of these patients had a clinically relevant increase in the respiratory rate or a clinically relevant decrease in oxygen consumption. So I think what we can say is that for these higher risk patients admitted to hospital, probably already on the ICU, HCQ is not a good drug. However, based on our data and more emerging observational data, we see that HCQ, especially in combination with zinc, can have a beneficial effect, much more beneficial, or let's say beneficial in comparison to the high-risk group patients. And so the question is, why is there not more research done and supported in the outpatient setting since a longer time, right? I mean, these study and investigations are still missing. We know high risk is a no-go, allow me to say, but with the patients at stage one and stage two with not such a progressed disease in a stage where antiviral therapy might be beneficial, more data would be appreciated. And based on the existing one, also more patients, in our opinion, could and should benefit. Next. What might be an additional role of zinc in COVID-19? I mean, there's more data published also that if zinc is added to HCQ, that mortality and hospital stays, the time of hospital stays is decreased, that treatment with zinc is associated with reduced in-hospital mortality. A new study coming out soon, currently available as a preprint, as you see here in bullet number two. In terms of an analysis of the predictive factors for critical illness of COVID-19 during treatment, a relationship between serum zinc level and critical illness was shown. Also prediction of survival odds in COVID-19 patients by zinc age and others showed a role of zinc as well. As there are first hints showing poor outcomes in patients with a zinc deficiency, for example, also at admission. Next. So this brings me back to Germany and the question, how is Germany doing in the pandemic? Next. And here you see the daily new cases in Germany after SARS-CoV-2 arrived. So in spring, we had then in March and end of March, also an exponential increase in daily new infections. And that was the time federal governments, as well as then the government of Germany decided to go for a strict lockdown. That was basically, in terms of the new cases, successful, as you can see here, also in the decrease of the daily infection rates. We then did not see during the summertime a lot of infections later after the holiday season or at the end of the holiday season. You see again a slight increase, also driven by tourists coming back to Germany, and as soon as we arrived in autumn, as unfortunately in many other countries, or you can say in Europe, in every country, we see again a tremendous increase in daily new cases. Next. In terms of daily deaths, I mean, in spring, of course, SARS-CoV-2 arrived, and the society was basically not prepared in terms of social distancing, safety measures, and of course the infection hit all the different risk populations in Germany, not as bad as in many other countries, thinking here also of Italy. But nevertheless, I mean, the significant increase in deaths, of course, was also a reason to go for a complete lockdown in Germany. Also having in mind the ICU capacity. We did better than other countries. I mean, Germany is has still good access to hospital care. We have a lot of ICU beds, but as I mentioned before, ICU beds are probably not the only solution to the pandemic. You see, in accordance with the infection rates during summertime, not so many infections anymore, but now, unfortunately, again, increasing and again, raising concerns in our hospitals in Germany when we might not have enough nurses anymore. So we have still a lot of beds available, but we also might run into issues if it is not better controlled, if we have enough staff available to take care about these patients. And that was the reason just recently the German government and also federal governments decided to go back again to a partial lockdown. Next. Concerning the guidelines in Germany, and here I included just information about the medication that is accessible for any physician who is interested in. He goes to the link or to the links you see on the bottom of the slides where usually these guidelines are published. There are certain drugs discussed, including chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, and mentioning that there is not a lot of good evidence, focusing, of course, on the unfortunately late-stage studies. They discuss other drugs, ritonavir as well, remdesivir, to be used in which patients, also steroids, for example, and others. I think what is for physicians an issue in the clinic, if you are not at a university center, as at one of the big ones, that it is recommended to include for most of these drugs and therapeutic options patients in studies. Of course, in smaller hospitals, these centers do not participate in these studies. So there's unfortunately not a lot of guidance. For sure, in the big centers, they have their local guidelines, but this might be also different from center to center as we see it in different countries. Next, if we go to the outpatients, there is a guideline available for primary care, but it is stated that in terms of drug therapy, there's no evidence-based treatment option available. The only recommendation is for positively tested patients with comorbidities, already showing a significant increase in D-dimers, to give prophylactic heparin. The guidelines focus on testing of patients, of management of patients in the doctor's office, and more or less on isolation of patients only, and when these patients should be transferred to a hospital. Next. So the question is, in terms of guidelines, are there better examples out there? I'm sure you are aware of many guidelines, maybe at your centers as well. But going through guidelines, personally, I found very interesting the one of Bahrain, the island Bahrain. And they started early with a very comprehensive guideline. Next. And this includes or tries to answer really most of the question of this pandemic, how to manage patients from diagnosis. They recommend, as we will see, a risk assessment and stratification of these patients. Very similar what Vladimir Zelenko did. They have a very concrete home isolation protocol in place, and they also have treatment guidelines in place, including also patients with mild to moderate symptoms. Next. So here you see the risk stratification, how or risk assessment patients that are contacting, for example, physicians and healthcare centers, when routine care is recommended, also concerning the testing. This means temperature less than 38 degrees. For example, no relevant symptoms, no shortness of breath and normal oxygen saturation, and no chest x-ray changes. They recommend a test during the next 24 hours, only if the patients have any of the shown comorbidities, and urgent care if patients are showing severe symptoms like shortness of breath, chest pain, etc., as you see on the right. So here, they have a clear risk assessment in place, how to manage these patients right from the beginning. Next. Concerning home isolation, I think also very interesting that patients need to meet certain criteria like age less than 60 years old, only asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic, absence of risk factors, appropriate home setting for self-isolation, and so on. I mean, they are for sure in a different situation, like bigger countries. They have a population of 1.8 million. They have isolation centers when patients cannot isolate them at home, etc., and admit them then also to hospital if needed. But nevertheless, I think it's a very interesting also recommendation when it comes to home isolation of certain patient groups. Next. And in terms of treatment recommendations for uncomplicated infections, they do not recommend patients just more or less treatments like for common cold and to stay at home. They mention to consider the use of zinc, vitamin C and vitamin D, and also the use of hydroxychloroquine if patients fit to certain criteria that are also defined in the guideline. Next. And indeed, let's call it a treatment protocol and not a guideline, I have to say. Nevertheless, concerning the dosage of medications for zinc, they recommend 50 milligram elementary zinc. Vitamin C, they have recommendations in vitamin D. And hydroxychloroquine, they recommend a loading dose the first day, and then they continue until day five with 200 milligram twice daily, as, for example, also used by Vladimir Zelenko in treating his patients. Next. Concerning the indication for hydroxychloroquine, they recommend it for adults with mild disease or asymptomatic adults with risk factors early during the course of the disease. And I think there's a typo, so this means less than 7 days after onset of symptoms. Next. And if we do a comparison, how these countries are doing, I think we are all aware that there are a lot of differences between these countries, different situations. Nevertheless, I think it's interesting to look also outside the own country, what other countries are doing and how they are doing in the pandemic. You know about the example of Sweden, who did not have lockdowns and especially at the beginning, not specific measures in place in terms of cases per million. They have less cases per million than, for example, the US, but they have more than Germany and countries around them like Norway. Total deaths per cases, they have 3.5%, and they have been criticized very much. The US has 2.25%. Germany, we have less cases still per million than other countries, and also less deaths is 1.6%. As I mentioned, we had early lockdowns. We have for sure very good still hospital care and sufficient ICU beds available. That might have been one reason. And Bahrain is, on the one hand, a younger society, 11 years, the average age is lower. But from the beginning, they were suffering from a lot of cases per million, as you can see. But also in comparison, they have really not a high number of deaths, with the lowest death rate per cases of 0.39%. As I said, many factors playing a role, but seeing what they do since very early in the pandemic in terms of their protocol and recommendations, for sure that is or can be a good example also for other countries to follow, and not only to manage the pandemic by lockdowns and waiting for vaccines. Next. So what is still missing in COVID-19 from perspective also of this presentation and data? It would be helpful to have comprehensive guidelines available and with continuous updates, even in Germany, I have to say. Also, it is worthwhile applying an appropriate risk stratification of COVID-19 patients, having treatment strategies aligned for outpatients and inpatients, because these patient populations are different, also based on continuously emerging evidence. This might need also a shift of some government approaches, what has to be driven, like, for example, a more comprehensive guideline. And it is important to mention from our perspective that medical treatment for early COVID-19 patients will still be needed even if an effective vaccine is available, as we see for the example of influenza. Hopefully, of course, less patients will be infected, will become sick, but the patients who will still contract COVID-19 should have also a treatment option very early in the course of the disease. Next. And with this, I want to thank you for your attention and being here, and I hope we still have time for some questions, including my co-authors of the study, Martin Scholz and Vladimir Zelenko. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Derwan.